Welcome back to eCrusade 2017. We are continuing through today at 4 p.m. Pacific time. Now, we have been bringing you continual broadcast daily of the Word of God on this year's theme. Our journey has taken us through who we are in Christ, the power given to us by God, when and how to use it, and what our expectations should be, enabling us to see God's power evidenced in His children. Our goal, my friends, is to bring enlightenment to your understanding of God's Word so that you will have a complete understanding of who you are in Christ and what that actually means to you. Now, bringing these anointed messages to you are preachers and teachers of the gospel of Jesus the Christ, and they will be joining us from around the globe. Our journey resumes right now, so join us as we gain the illumination of God's Word. Okay. Well, I didn't put the sound effect in, so bring. All right, now, my friends, are you finding yourself completely dependent on God? Well, if you desire to come into and dwell in the miraculous presence of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, you know, if you desire to put on the armor of God and be in Christ, if you wish to avail yourself of His marvelous wisdom and power, then you know what? You have to give your life to Him. It's very simple. It's pain-free. And in just a moment, Pastor Karen and I are going to give you that opportunity. And except I have to do this.
Yeah. this manger king, my everything. Love came for me.
Jesus and talk about the children and of God and children of Jesus and their power. And we're giving you your platform now to receive him as your Lord and Savior, to walk with him the rest of your life and realize the blessing that he has, the plans that he has to prosper you. We do this with a very simple prayer. We say a very simple prayer. It's called the Sinner's Prayer. We also talk about discipling you and giving you our information, any of the ministers that are here today. And discipleship is very important because many people think that we say the Sinner's Prayer, we go to church once in a while, and we continue to live our life like we have lived in the past, and that's we're going to be received into heaven. As a born-again believer, we are transformed through the Holy Spirit to be more like Christ. So it's an exciting journey. There will be some tribulation, but once you've met Jesus and seen his presence, you never want to turn back. So we're going to give you that opportunity today to welcome you into the kingdom. So we're going to be saying this simple prayer. We begin our Christian walk with with this prayer, the Sinner's Prayer, and you're going to repeat this after me. God has given us a gift. It's through his grace. He's given us a gift of repentance from all our sin, past, present, and future. Sin that we don't even, we may commit in the future that he knows we're going to commit. He has given us that gift through his blood. He will instantly pardon your infinite debt today. So just repeat this after me. Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of the living God. You were born, came in the flesh to atone for my sins and all of my sickness and disease on the cross. And you were raised from the dead after 3 days. I come to you now, Lord, with a humble heart, and I repent of all my sin, known and unknown. And I know that this sin that I committed was against you, but that you took my place and raised me up even while I was continuing to sin. And Lord, I ask you to forgive me of all of this sin. Lord, I ask you to come into my heart today so that I can receive that heart connection with you. I make you my Lord and Savior now and forever. I thank you, Lord, for your grace, your love, your mercy, and your compassion for me. I believe that once I was lost, but now I am found. I choose to serve you. I choose to serve you all the days of my life. Family, if you prayed that prayer, we welcome you. We're excited for you. Hallelujah. You're now in the kingdom of God. And we pray that the Holy Spirit, for the Holy Spirit anointing on you. And we pray also that your walk will be blessed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You know, one of the most interesting things that we offer on this program is Old Testament history on Holy Communion. And Pastor Karen has a very special anointing for that, so I'm going to ask her to share that with us now.
Okay, thank you, Pastor Stephanie. Passover is such an interesting holiday because it relates to the Jews, but it relates to all of us. It was a foreshadowing of the communion service that we're going to be having today. It was a foreshadowing of Jesus shedding his blood for us, a foreshadowing of our baptism, a foreshadowing of our resurrected life with Christ. So over 3,500 years ago, the Hebrew people were slaves to the Egyptians. And as you know, God hardened Pharaoh's heart. And Pharaoh was the king of the Egyptians, and God hardened his heart so that he would be unwilling to release the Hebrews and allow them to return to Israel. So God decided that he would send 10 plagues upon the Egyptians. And this is going to be repeated in the end times also. There's going to be many plagues. And, you know, we appreciate everyone who came forward to be saved today, because we are in the grace dispensation. But God sent 10 plagues upon the Egyptians, and the 10th plague resulted in the death angel moving from house to house, taking the lives of the firstborn, both men and beast, of the Egyptians. Now God told the Hebrews to sacrifice a lamb and put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost of their houses. This is the foreshadowing of the Lord Jesus Christ on the lintels of the doorpost, the top and the sides of the doors of their house, and that they would be protected. The firstborn would be protected. And he said to them to sacrifice a lamb and put the blood of the lamb on these doorposts. And of course, I always like to point out that he told the Hebrews to choose every year for Passover, to choose the lamb without blemish. In Exodus 12:13, God said, "When I see the blood being the life of Jesus, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you." So thus the firstborn and of the Hebrew families and all of the families were protected from both sickness and death as a result of the blood and body of the Lamb. So you see that the appointed festival of Passover becomes the forerunner of the Lord's Supper, where the Lord Jesus himself was with his disciples in the upper room, and where he becomes the sacrificial lamb, and his blood is shed on the cross for not only our sins, but for our complete salvation. In the Greek is a complete package for us, a complete protection, complete healing, complete salvation, and complete deliverance, or in the Hebrew, they like to say shalom. Now Jesus sat down with his disciples and said, and I'm paraphrasing this, "I am going to fulfill this festival." In fact, we understand that Jesus was having Passover with his disciples when he instituted the Last Supper with a new covenant, whereby would they not only emphasize their deliverance from Egypt, but each time that they took the cup of wine, referring to Jesus' blood, and the unleavened bread, referring to his body, they would celebrate deliverance from sin and the promise of eternal life. You see, the blood of the Lamb in Egypt was a foreshadowing of the blood of Jesus, who was identified as the Lamb of God by John the Baptist in John 1:29. John said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." So the historical application of Passover is that we see its prophetic fulfillment in Christ, who is God's final perfect Lamb, died during the festival of Passover and redeemed us forever from our sin and raised us up with him into eternal life. Now, communion also denotes a sharing, a unity in Christ, a sharing of the elements and a unity in his body, and reminds us not only of our redemption, but also our future inheritance with him in the kingdom of God. Matthew 26:29 says, "But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth. I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the day I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom." So communion began actually back, foreshadowing it in at the time of the exodus of the Jews out of Egypt. It also is brought forward at the Passover of the Last Supper with Jesus and his disciples, and it continues today so that we can share, all of us can share as a unified body in the blood and body of Christ. So as we look at the elements, looking at the unleavened bread, which we had just talked about previously, it's unleavened because the Hebrews took all of their leaven out of their houses, which related to the pride, that they could not have any pride because there was forgiveness of sins at this particular festival. So they took the unleavened bread and the wine or juice, referring to Christ's blood. The Jewish unleavened bread used during Passover was called the bread of affliction because of the Hebrew slavery in Egypt. However, with the new covenant in Jesus, it is called the bread of life. Jesus said in John 6, verse 32 through 33, I tell you for certain that Moses was not the one who gave you the bread from heaven. And the bread that God gives is the one who came down from heaven to give life to the world. And Jesus, being on the breath of God, said, I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger. He that believes in me shall never thirst. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. And if any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. And whoever eats my flesh, which is his glorified body now, and drinks my blood, the life of Christ, the eternal life in Christ, remains in me and I in him. Your forefathers ate manna and died, but he who feeds on this bread will live forever. So family, we are proclaiming the Lord's death through this service, but also remember Jesus said in John 6 that we have no life in us unless we continue to partake of his flesh and of his body and of his blood. So we... in healing, and Pastor Stephanie's going to tell you a little bit more about the healing process, but in taking this service today, we are able to heal this communion service today. We are able to impart the life of Jesus into our bodies, and he's perfect, whole, nothing missing, well, nothing missing or broken in his body. So we praise you for this service today, and thank you, Pastor Stephanie.
Amen.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. And we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. And so we share in this bread. Drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the King. The body of our Savior Jesus Christ tore. That healed the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. Table of the King. table of the King.
One of the marvelous things that we receive from coming to the table of the King is healing of our bodies and our minds. Now, you can receive your healing simply by taking Holy Communion. However, we have to prepare before partaking. And you know, the Old Testament elements of the covenant still remain today. Jesus and his disciples had bread and wine on the table when they shared the Last Supper. As Pastor Karen told you, these items were familiar to all of them because they had used them to celebrate the Passover. Now, Jesus used those particular items to draw the picture he wanted his disciples to see. That's why we use them today. But it doesn't matter what food items you do use. Use what you have available to you. It's perfectly acceptable because we pray over the items, sanctifying them as the body and the blood of Christ. So you need to believe that those elements of the covenant become the body and the blood of Christ. Now, the Word of God tells us that the first thing that we absolutely must do is discern the body of Christ. We do that by acknowledging that the bread or whatever food item you're using as the body of Christ is the vibrancy of the life of Jesus, his supernatural healing and wholeness. That because of his body and his blood, you supernaturally have become bone of Jesus' bone and flesh of Jesus' flesh. That you're now filled with his perfection and power, completely healed, completely made whole, and completely restored to his divine health. You can think of it as medicine, if you want to. It's like a pill that's glowing with the Shekinah glory of God. And that medicine is healing you as it travels through your mouth and down into your body. As it goes, it's pushing out all darkness, which is sickness and disease, and it's pushing it out from the inside out. Visualize that condition you're plagued with, that sickness or disease being on Jesus' body. Put whatever your ailments are on him. Use your imagination now, because you're not giving him something he doesn't want. He already took it at the cross, remember? The enemy's trying to trick you into taking it by deceiving you into thinking that you've got it through lying symptoms. But since Jesus took it at the cross, you are already healed and made whole. So put that lying symptom back on Jesus in the same place on him that you've been afflicted. In other words, see yourself without the problem. See yourself with the solution. This is called spiritual visualization. It's vital that you understand it and do it. Now, if you have been diagnosed with a problem and are being treated by a doctor, then continue your treatment and medications, but add to it your faith and your taking of Holy Communion for healing and restoration. Remember, too, that we believe in doctors, so don't just try to go into denial and believe away your situations. See a doctor and get a name for what's plaguing you. Why? Because with everything with a name has to bow to the name of Jesus. Now, the next thing we do in preparation is discern the blood of Christ. We discern it. There we go. I'm sorry. I have this hissing noise going on and I didn't like it. We discern it as the forgiveness of all sin, past, present, and future, the restoration of the blessing to your life, and the power and the authority of God in your life in full operation, which is humongous. Receiving God's provision and protection as receiving the gift of righteousness from Jesus the Christ, and thank God for his plan of redemption and that you've been included in it, that you've been given eternal life, and now you no longer live under the law, but you live under his grace. Now, lift up the elements of the covenant. These are the items I asked you to assemble at the beginning of the program. Lift them up before the Lord, and if you're not able to lift them, then hover your hand over them or point to them as I pray. Father, as we praise you and worship you with these elements of the covenant, we thank you that your only begotten Son, Jesus, gave his life sacrificially so that we may live and have life more abundantly. We thank you now as this food item becomes our portion of his healing body and the vibrancy of his life within us. We thank you that as we partake of the body of Christ, we become healed and made whole, completely restored. We thank you that this beverage becomes our portion of his cleansing blood, that we're continually washed in the waterfall of his precious blood and renewed within as we continually remember his act of love on the cross on our behalf. In the name above all names, the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. You know, the Lord's Supper is a personal fellowship. It's actually a partnership with Christ. And partaking of one bread creates partnership between all the members, the disciples as well. It merges us into one body, and that's known as the church. Now, the Word of God commands us to eat the bread and drink the cup. to continually take the bread, give thanks, and break it, then eat it, then take the cup, give thanks, and drink it, all while we're in remembering what Jesus did for us at the cross. So the Lord commanded that the supper be repeated often, but Paul doesn't give us any instruction as to the frequency that we're supposed to celebrate it. So he implies, though, that it's to be done with frequency, and the reason for that is that partaking of the Lord's Supper recalls to our mind continually the redemption of ourselves by Christ from all sickness, all disease, and all sin. He leaves it open-ended on purpose so that you can do it as often as you want to and need to. There's no limitations. Now, as we're instructed, we discern the body and the blood of Christ as we prepare to partake. On the night that he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we thank you that this item of food has become the bread of life and has become the healing body of our Lord Jesus the Christ. The body of our Lord Jesus broken for you, so that every cell, every tissue, every organ and bone, all systems, cardiovascular, neurological, blood vascular, lymphatic, gastrointestinal, urinary, muscular, skeletal, all of them, all systems are totally aligned with God's word and his will, that you are and remain healed and made whole, completely and totally restored to divine health. In the name of Jesus, our healer, the Christ, we pray. Amen. Partake of the body of our Lord and Savior. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Father, we thank you that this beverage has become the precious saving blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. My friends, the blood of our Lord Jesus shed for you in celebration of his finished work on the cross, for the remission of all of your sins, past, present, and future, for the restoration of the empowerment of God, the blessing in your life, in full operation and the gift of righteousness. In the name of Jesus, our Redeemer and Savior the Christ, we pray. Amen. Partake of the blood of our Lord and Savior. My friends, I'm delighted this year to introduce to you one of our newer contributors. He was here with us last year, too. Comes from Pakistan. His name is Pastor Emmanuel Samuel, and each of the speakers is asked to provide a biographical information, and because Pastor Samuel's is uniquely his own, I'm going to read it to you from the first person. I'm from Honeywell, Punjab, Pakistan. I'm born in Honeywell. I'm the only person educated from my family. But now I belong to a rich family of Jesus. I studied in St. Joseph High School from playgroup to eighth grade. I got admission into one of the government schools where I completed my 10th class matriculation. I studied 12 class FA in Multan Board. I continued my study even after my marriage and sent admission for graduation with Allama Iqbal Open University and completed it. I am trained as a teacher. I did a commuter course and many courses on rehabilitation and management. I am a community-based rehabilitation worker, and we have many children from very different, all the different villages from whom we teach Bible study. And many children have learned Bible verses, Bible stories, worship songs, and activities from Sunday school. I thank God as I'm on my heavenly journey on this planet as a born-again Christian, serving God in Pakistan, in outreach areas, and even I use my home for the church and for all the activities. My aim is to target people who are away from God, who do not go to any church, who do not want to pray, and I reach out to them, sharing with them the Word of God. My wife Bushra and I invite them to come and join us in our prayer meetings. I offer my wife and I to come to their home also to pray as a family and explain the Word of God. I was raised in a Catholic background, but have become a born-again Christian. As I was going away from God, God was coming toward me. I was tired of ritual prayers, so I stopped even going to the church. Always busy, busy, and busy. One night, God showed me in a dream. He invited me to join his army to heal the people in his name. I saw a huge white light that disappeared after a few minutes, and after that, I thanked God and started going to prayer meetings and crusades. I started a new journey with God as a new creature in Christ Jesus in 2005. It was during a very tough time when my life had become too rough. My mother died from my and my father was retired. I had no job and I had accepted Jesus. Shortly after that, I started working for God, not as a part of the Catholic Church. I had nothing in hand, no bank balance, just hand to mouth. But I thank God for his promise for me for the daily bread, and he provided me. And I and my wife started working separately, Open Matthew Rehabilitation Center, where we give physiotherapy exercises to many patients with disabilities. Many are healed even though they belong to other faiths or religions. We have been working for the Lord in this way since 1995, and I thank God who cares for us in our walk of our lives. Our God is good. We don't have any permanent work, but my God is a living God who makes a way where there is no way. Where our thinking failed to work, God's wisdom started working in me. And I thank God as I serve God as he gave me a healing ministry of Jesus. I thank God for Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International for helping me in ministry work. And I'm always in prayer for Dr. Stephanie and for the ministry. May Jesus bless her always and keep her upon us as the best Bible teacher. I praise God for the accomplishment as it is my passion, my mission, that many people are baptized and may many hear his holy word and many have word of God in their families for the devotion, as it's an urgent need, as Jesus is coming very soon. Every child around us should have life and life in abundance. I pray many have holy Bibles for the gospel mission in Pakistan to continue the mission. Many children can receive holy Bibles, old or new clothes, old shoes, books. What do they call those things that they wear on their backpacks to feed them once a week and so on. Please pray for the widows as they are thought to cut off from the families or societies, but we invite them in our prayer meeting to pray with them, counsel them, and always tell them to look on Jesus only because we find provision only in him. May I decrease and he increase who provides me at the right time when I'm in need. May we all be covered with peace, joy, and love. May we care for others as God cares for us. Your brother and humble servant of God, Pastor Emmanuel Samuel. My friends, I give you Pastor Emmanuel Samuel.
Kingdom greetings in the powerful name of Jesus. I am Pastor Emmanuel Samuel from Pakistan. And today, as God has given me this opportunity to speak on who we are in Christ, first of all, we all must thank God for being his followers, as it is mentioned and very clearly in the word of God. If we read Isaiah chapter 43 verse 21, "This people have I formed for myself, they shall show forth my praise." God created us all to praise him, to thank him in everything we do, because he is our creator. So it is time to thank him, to know him, to be with him. Let us seek together who we are in Christ. So let us close our eyes and bow down our heads before we learn together who we are in Christ. Faithful Heavenly Father, I thank you for your Son Jesus Christ, whom you sent for me, for my family, for my friends, and for the whole world. Your Son, who is a perfect Son, whose name is Jesus Christ, who was, who is, and who is to come. Lord, I thank you to send your Son Jesus to make us new being, who believes in your Son is saved. Lord, you have created us on your own image. Lord, you have engraved me on your palms. Lord, you want each one of us to be holy like you. I thank you, Father, for using me for your glory to share your word with my limited knowledge. Lord, I ask you to guide me through the power of the Holy Spirit. May this be from you, Lord. My beloved God, help me. Help me, Father, to realize today I am nothing without you. Help me to draw many people to you, as you have given all of us a very big responsibility to draw many people to you, O Lord. As it is written in Mark 16 and verse 15, he said to them, "Go into the whole world and preach the gospel to all the creation. Thank you for being my savior, making me free, although we all make many mistakes in every step we take, but you are a merciful Father who forgives us and gives us new life through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, I ask more of your wisdom on a word as I speak today. May it not be from me, but from you. All what have asked in prayers, Lord, I ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We bless you, Lord. Lord, we bless your name. Praise the Lord once again. God has brought us together to speak about who we are in Christ. My dear brothers and sisters, as we know who we are in Christ, and in the introduction, when we are born, we are given a birth certificate with the details who our parents are, as well as the place and the date of our birth. This becomes an ID for life, often needing to be proceed to prove our identity at various times. As we grow, we gather other ID items, a student card, a license, photos, a passport, a possibly a marriage certificate. And we say time goes on and identity changes, as well as a variety of library, bank and credit cards with their PIN numbers. These articles identify who we are and give us access to certain places or information. When we are born, we also inherit a lot of things: a family name, a family background, race, gender, social status, education and skills development, etc. Personality traits and tendencies, and lots more. These things do not determine our choices or our future, but they do greatly influence them. Along life's journey, our identity emerges further and is shaped by both the environment we live in and the choices we make. When we become a Christian, the Bible describes this experience as such a radical event that it's like a being born again. When we are born again, out of his great love, God chooses to give us the right or privilege to become his children. If we read John 1 and verse 12 to 13 and 1 John chapter 3 verses 1 through 3. He adopted us into His family. He adopted us into His family in Christ. A phrase "in Christ" is used almost 100 times in the New Testament. We have proposed and a new nature with godly tendencies. We become a brand new identity with Christ, a totally new person. The trouble is, most of us don't know who we are. We are still living by the old ID card. We are living by the old ID card. Who we are. Who we are in Christ. Paul wrote to some believers who lived in Ephesus to remind them of the blessings that they have because of being in Christ. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 1, 2, and 3. In Christ is a description of our new spiritual position or identity due to our relationship with Jesus Christ. The Father has chosen us. He has adopted us and accepted us into His family. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4 to 6. Jesus the Son has redeemed us. He has forgiven us, revealed God's will to us, and made us His. And if we read Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7 to 12, the Holy Spirit has sealed us, and is a deposit assuring us of God, completing His work in us. So God is completing His work in us. All of this is to the praise of His God's glory. It's only for the glory of God to praise Him. And if we read Ephesians chapter 1, verse 6 to 12 and 14, Paul goes on to pray for them that they would realize what is in the bank. So to speak, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15 to 23, many Christians never read the balance sheet to see what they have been given. What they have given in Christ. We need to discover who we are in Christ and the riches that are available to us because of our family, because of our family heritage. It is so important that we know our, understand this truth. These spiritual realities need to become revelation to those and a revelation to us, so that affect the way we view and live out our present natural reality and who we are in Christ. Who we are in Christ. So Paul is in prison. So we see that Paul is in prison. In the natural, he is poor, oppressed, weak, and vulnerable. And in the spiritual, he is a victor, victorious person, a strong person who has defeated the devil. Overall, he had revelation of who he was in Christ. So Paul then goes on to speak of our position in Christ. If we read Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 22, says another prayer for them. And if we go further and read Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1 to 21, and finally, our responsibilities now that we are in Christ. So if we read all this chapter and we read Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 6, Christ had done his part. Christ has done his part. Now we need to do our part. So we have to do now our part. We need to be who we are. Put to death the old nature. Tear up the old ID cards and put on your new nature. Live by your new ID card. We need to be know who we are in Christ. So this is a time to see. This is a time to see that we have so much in Christ. So this passage of scripture is only a beginning. Have a look at the attached list of other benefits we have in Christ. Our acceptance, our security, and our significance, making it work now, the truth God says through the prophet Hosea says, my people, what does he says? My people are destroyed through lack of knowledge. We don't know who we are and what God has done for us. Jesus said, know the truth and the truth will set you free. And if we read John chapter 8, verse 13, 31 to 32, read God's word. So read God's word about you, reality. Ask for revelation of the word by the Spirit. God has revealed the truth about his nature. So we see that God has revealed the truth about his nature, about his character and purpose. And purpose through Jesus and the scriptures. And we keep on going to relate ourselves, our lives with Jesus Christ, that who we are in Christ, because through Jesus Christ our salvation is. The demand of the today's time is whether we are in Christ or not. If we are in Christ, we have to think. We have to question ourselves. We have to not point our fingers on to the others, but we have to point our fingers to ourselves. It must go to ourselves whether we are in Christ or not. We have saved who have purchased us with his own blood. So this is a time when we have to make a decision how we can be faithful in his calling. He is calling us, each one of us, not to me or to some people, but he is calling to each one of us by our names. He is telling everyone that we come to him, we come back to him like a prodigal son. It's a time to love him because he loved us first. Our love must not be ritual, not just from the head level. If we are in Christ fully and totally and completely, we possess all His values, all the authorities through His word, because every word of God is inspired by Himself. He has inspired everything. He has inspired the word. And it is written, I know the word of God is written by man, but inspired by God. So we have to be fully into His word. God has given us free will to accept Him or to reject Him. So we have to today make a decision that who we are in Christ. And if we are in Christ, we have to today make a choice to accept Him. To make a choice to accept Him. God is pleased with His Son Jesus Christ, who says in John 14 verse 9, "Who has seen me, seen my Father." So He says very clearly that who sees me, sees my Father. How can you say, "Show us the Father"? Therefore, it is not going to be very safe if you are going to be in Christ. You have to face hardships. Many storms will be there on your ways. But you are really in Christ. So if you are really in Christ, you will be conqueror. You will defeat the devil. You will defeat even the power of the death. Because God has given you everything. He has created you on your own image. So He gives you His powers also. So let us break down every barrier that stops us to follow Christ. The time is very near. We have to make a right choice. Let us, Jesus, take control of our every thought, our every action. Let us make a deeper communication with whom, who has sent us. We are not of this world, but we are spirit being. This is a journey. We are here on this journey because Paul says it is very clear in the Philippians. So in the Philippians, if we read the Philippians chapter 1 verse 21, "For to me to live is Christ." And we all have to make the decision like this, as Paul says, that "For me to live is Christ and to die is gain." So if we are in Christ, we have to live like Christ. So let us start from today, because we do not know about tomorrow. We do not know about the next hour, about the next minute, about the next second. But we have to make a decision right now. We have to make a decision today onward. Let us question ourselves. So this is a time to question ourselves, not to question others, but to question ourselves, who we are in Christ, what Christ demands us today. Because God has given us everything. God has given us His word, because He came to give life and life in abundance. So today, to be like Him, He says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." So it's a time to keep His commandments, because He loves us, and love covers everything. And we remain in Christ if we love one another. So today is a time to think and to question ourselves, who we are in Christ. So if we are in Christ, we have all that the Christ possess. So if we are in Christ, we have to forgive. If we are in Christ, we have to love. And if we are in Christ, we have to face the hardships of this world. And on this shorter journey, we are on this journey, and we have to be completely in Christ, completely in God, completely in His love, because He loves us. And we have to keep on loving to other, keep on become the peacemaker, because Jesus is the world's best peacemaker. Our God is love. So may Jesus bless you, and thank you very much, and may God bless you. And I pray that this small message, that who we are in Christ, bless us, bless our families, and may this message be not only in our words, but it must be in our actions. And this is a time to see and to know ourselves and to know God through our deeper communication with God. May God bless you, and pray that may Jesus bless you through this small message that God has given me to share with you. God bless you. Have a beautiful day, and have a blessed day there, so that may God be in our all our prayers, in all our prayers through Jesus Christ. Because when we accept Jesus Christ, we accept the Father. And when we accept all His values, so God gives us the authority. God gives us all that we need. So today is a time to know that who we are in Christ. So if we are in Christ, God will bless us with each and everything, with every single need. God bless you. Have a blessed day there.
Thank you, Pastor Emmanuel, for that wonderful message. It certainly was interesting and informative, and it's been a blessing. God bless you.
Hold on. Still there's no way out, and it seems like pain is all you gain.
Sounds to me like our music is glitching out, so we will play it. But it's a good message. Hold on no matter what. You know, on this final day of our e-crusade, I've been led by the Lord to share this message with you all on the power of God in the believer's life and how to access it. You know, my friends, we should study the Bible. Well, yes, Dr. Stephanie, we know that, so tell us why. Because it's the only source of truth. Jesus said in John 17, verse 17, "Thy word is truth." You know, that's a great statement, especially in our world today where everyone's looking for the truth. I mean, look at the cynicism of Pontius Pilate, who said, "What is truth?" Every pastor, teacher, theologian suggests that we study the Bible because the Bible is not only the source of truth, it's the source of happiness and it's the source of joy. In fact, I quote from the words of Jesus that, "If you hear my words and keep them, my joy will remain in you." So the words of John, These things I write unto you, that your joy may be full. The words of Proverbs, happy is the man who hears me. The words of Luke 11:28, happy are they who hear the word of God and obey it. That's the source of joy. You study the word, you hear what it says, you draw out its principles, you obey those principles. Why? Because it's your heart to obey them. And God pours out the blessings and the joy. Listen, you can crank out obedience in every legalistic manner you want to, but if in your heart you didn't want to do it and you were fighting against it, it would never give you the joy. Because you see, to do good deeds without a right heart doesn't count. Let me show you what I mean. The Bible talks about fruit. It talks about different kinds of fruit, and it talks about the fruit of the Spirit. And that's attitude stuff. And before there's ever fruit in your life, like winning people to Christ or studying the Word of God or whatever else the Bible talks about as fruit, praise, giving all the good works, but before the fruit on the outside means anything, it's got to come from the fruit of the Spirit on the inside. Now hear this, action fruit, things you do with attitude fruit, what you feel is pure legalism, Phariseeism. You can bring out all the stuff you want on the outside. You can be a legalist to the teeth, like the Pharisees, and you'll never know joy. On the other hand, if your heart is a heart of obedience and a heart of attitude, you can fail on the outside and God will give you the joy because he sees the gracious, obedient spirit in your heart. That's what he's after. So the promise is this, study the Bible. Why? Number one, it's the source of truth. And number two, it's the source of rejoicing. You say, hey, Dr. Stephanie, I really appreciate what you're saying, but I've got news for you. I study the Bible all the time, and I've got lots of pain. I've got lots of problems. Well, I've got a verse for you. Fortunately, I don't want to leave you hanging with that thought. God doesn't tell you just exactly when you're going to get the joy, right? You might have to wait a little while. So in John 16, he looks at the disciples and says to them, I'm leaving. And they're just all just sitting there moping. They had put all their proverbial eggs into one basket. Everybody left his trade. They've all been following Jesus for 3 years. And then Jesus ups and says one day, hey, I'm gone. I'm gone now, guys. I'm going to leave and I'm going to have to go away. And that's just the way it is. Well, they're all going, whoa, wait a minute. We joined this baby thinking that the kingdom was going to come. What's wrong? Something's happened here. They were exceedingly sorrowful and extremely sad. And Jesus said in John 16, verse 20, verily, verily, I say to you, you shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice. You shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow will be turned into joy. In other words, you've got to realize that sometimes there's going to be sorrow before you'll ever see joy. In fact, my friends, listen, let me tell you something interesting. If you didn't know sorrow, you wouldn't understand joy when it came. That's right. If you didn't know pain, you wouldn't know pleasure. I was reading recently an interesting little article that was saying the difference between an itch and a tickle can't be defined medically, and yet a tickle is something that makes you happy, and an itch is something that irritates. It's a very fine line. Actually, medical research has shown that an itch is an extremely low level of pain. The difference between pleasure and pain has a really fine line. For example, sometimes there's nothing more wonderful than a really hot shower. And you'll get it ready and really hot, and then you stick in just one elbow or your hand or whatever to see if you can stand it. And then you just sort of ease into it, and you relax into it, and it's pleasurable because it's really hot now. But as you were feeling your way into it, you actually experience pain. Then all of a sudden, ah, that's the thin line between pain and pleasure. You know, I know a person, I consider him a friend of mine, but he's really an acquaintance, who played football when he was in college. And he told me that all through college, he faced that thin line of pain and pleasure. You torture your body like some kind of maniac, and it's full of pain, and yet all the time you're loving it. You know, with some sort of horrific kind of pleasure, you're loving it. Again, that's the thin line between pain and pleasure. And I guess if we didn't know pain, we wouldn't know pleasure. If we didn't know pain, we wouldn't know the joy that pleasure can bring. Now, I've often thought that it's possible that God allows sorrow in our lives so that we'll understand joy when it does come. So Jesus says, you're going to have sorrow for a little while, but be patient, be patient. Listen, if you obey the word of God, he'll give you that joy. It may not be instantaneous the way that you would like to have it, but it will always be there when you need it. So why should I study the Bible? What should motivate me to Bible study? I mean, one, the Bible is the source of truth, right? And two, the Bible is a source of joy. And I'll tell you, no matter what happens in my life, when I study the Word of God, there's an exhilaration and a joy that is untouchable by any circumstance or situation. Number three, the Word is the source of victory. I don't know about any one of you, but I like to win. I don't like to lose. I look at life this way. Whatever you're going to do, do it with a spirit of excellence. Give it all you have. I grew up with that kind of mentality, striving for excellence, laying it all down on the line. I want to be on top, the winner, successful in every endeavor. You know, the Word promises us in the Old Testament that if we obey God's Word, He will make us the head and not the tail. However, one of the things that gives me great joy is that once you're born again, Jesus gives us the mind of Christ. And as a gift, we have that. So watch this now. We are the head. And always will be the head once we're born again, since the tail has left the equation. Hallelujah. I won't give the enemy any advantage over me. As it says in Corinthians, I won't allow Satan to be victorious in my life in any part of it at all. I don't want to see the flesh override my spirit. I have a desire to win. You know, we need to be like that as Christians, winners. Listen, there's no reason to give in to the enemy. As you study the Bible, you'll find out that the Word of God becomes your source of victory. David said this, and you'll remember it well. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. The Word of God is the very source of victory over sin. As the Word of God is taken in, it becomes the resource which the Holy Spirit uses to direct us. It puts handles on us for the Holy Spirit to grab onto so we won't slip away. Look, you have no way of preventing yourself from being led into sin, yet when the Word of God is there, the Holy Spirit can kick it into your conscious mind. You know, I'll tell you something really simple. As a Christian, you'll never function on what you know, what you don't know. It will never happen. You'll never be able to operate on the principle you never knew. That makes sense. You'll never be able to apply the truth you haven't discovered. So as you feed into your mind the Word of God, it becomes a handle by which the Spirit of God holds on to you and directs and guides you. Now, let's see our example, the fourth chapter of Matthew. This is the classic illustration of facing Satan with the Word of God. Here we meet Jesus Christ, and it says in verse 1, Then was Jesus led up by the Spirit, capital S, Holy Spirit, into the wilderness to be tested or tempted by the devil. Now, as far as God was concerned, my friends, it was a test because he couldn't fail and wouldn't fail. As far as Satan was concerned, it was a temptation because he hoped he would. The word can mean either one, periasmos, which means a temptation, or a testing. It's a neutral word. It can mean good or bad. From Satan's angle, he wanted it to be bad. From God's angle, he knew that it would be good. So, the Spirit, Holy Spirit now, drove Jesus into the wilderness, knowing he'd pass the test. Satan was there waiting for him, hoping that he'd fail. After he had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterwards hungry. That's not surprising. 40 days without food? That's not surprising at all. But it's interesting to me that because Jesus was such a perfect human being, without sin, his body must have had powers beyond anything that we have ever experienced or would experience. He must have been so strong and so virile and so much of whatever humanness could be in its untapped potential, at least as we know it, that he wasn't overwhelmingly hungry or for all those 40 days until afterwards when he really knew the gnawing pangs of hunger. Now, finally, after 40 days, the temper came to him and the tempter came to him and gave him three temptations. You remember them. In each case, Jesus answered the word of God with the word of God. First, he said, If thou be the Son of God, command these stones to be made bread. What's he really saying to him? Well, this is what it is. Listen, you're the Son of God. You're God in human flesh. You're the Messiah. You deserve better than this. What are you doing out in this devastation? What are you doing out here in the boondocks up from Jericho where you're... What are you doing out here? In this wretched wilderness, inhabited by wild beasts and creeping things, what are you doing out here starving to death? You're the Son of God. Grab some satisfaction, man. Make some bread. You deserve it. He was really tempting him to go against God's plan to grab his own satisfaction. He was saying, Do your own thing. Don't depend on God. God hasn't met your need yet. Here you've been 40 days. You're hungry. You're worthy of more than this. He was really tempting him to distrust the care of God. He answered and said, "It is written." And he quoted Deuteronomy, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." What he was saying was, look, God promised he'd care for me. I'll keep my trust in his promise. I'll never use my own powers to violate the promise of God. He countered with the temptation with the word of God. Then the devil takes him into the holy city, Jerusalem, elevates him up to the pinnacle of the temple, probably on the protruding strut that sticks out over the valley of Hinnom. That would be as much as maybe 300-foot drop straight down. Okay, so the devil set him up there, and he said, "Why don't you dive off? Cast yourself down. After all, you want to quote scripture? I'll quote it to you. He shall give his angels charge over you, and they shall bear thee up, lest that at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone." You want to trust God? You're going to hang on to God? You're not going to make bread? You're going to believe God? Well, why don't you just really believe God and take a swan dive off of here and see if he fulfills his word? Sounds good. Satan's clever. You want to tell me how much you trust God? Here's a good way to prove it. Dive off. Let him catch you. And Jesus said, "It is written," again, "thou shalt not put the Lord thy God to the test." You trust God? Said Jesus, you don't presume on God. You believe him to care for you on the trip. You don't lay down on the freeway. There's a difference. Now, Satan shows him from a high mountain all the kingdoms of the world. And he says, look, I'll give you all that stuff if you fall down and worship me. And Jesus said to him, get out of here, Satan. One was bad enough. Two is intolerable. Three is absolutely enough. Leave. For it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord God, and him only shalt thou serve. And what followed then was the devil left, and the angels came and ministered to Jesus, and God fulfilled all his promises. What's the point? It's this. Jesus answered the temptation of Satan three times, and every time he quoted directly out of the Old Testament. As a Christian, it's the capturing of biblical truth in your conscious mind that gives you the capacity to defeat Satan. You can't do it on your own. Jesus literally triumphed over the divine through the word of God. Excuse me, I have a frog in my throat. He triumphed over the divine through the word of God. Now, it's the source of victory. You can't reason. You can't just try to wrestle with Satan. You know, it's incredible. People imagine that they can argue Satan out of his temptation using their own logic. It simply can't be done. Another interesting illustration is Luke 4, verse 33. In the synagogue, there was a man which had a spirit of an unclean demon, and he cried out with a loud voice. Now, he was demon-possessed in the synagogue, and he must have been disruptive of the services there. He kept saying, "Let us alone. What have we done with you? Be thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us?" This fellow's just full of these demons, and they're all hollering at the same time. "I know thee, who thou art, the Holy One of God." And Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Hold thy peace and come out of him." And when the demon had thrown him down in the midst, the man, he didn't throw Jesus down, and hurt him not, and they were all amazed, and spoke among themselves, saying, "What word is this? For with authority and power he commanded the unclean spirits, and they just came out." You know what Jesus did right there? He established his authority and his power over Satan with his word. With one word, he just vanquished the demons. With one word, he said, "Begone, Satan." And with one word, he chased a legion of demons out of the man. They said of him, "Never had a man spoken like this man. He speaks as a man of authority, not like the scribes and the Pharisees." Now pay close attention. The word of Jesus Christ is absolutely authoritative. Now, when you know the word of God, you'll know victory. Let me show you one other illustration in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17, in Paul's discussion of the armor of the Christian. Now, we find that it wraps up with this great piece of armor in verse 17. "Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God." This is a tremendous text. He says the final piece of armor is the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. All right, let me ask you this. Now, when you think of a sword, you think of probably think of some 5-foot-long thing that he can wield and flail around, right? Well, that's not what this is. That's the Greek word rompheia. The word here is the Greek word for sword, which is makaria. All right? Makaria is a Greek word referring to a short, small dagger. So, the sword of the spirit is not a huge broadsword that you just flail around hoping you whack off the head of the demon sooner or later. It's not something used indiscriminately and wildly. It's not buying a great big hardcover New American Standard Bible and beating demons in the head with it. It isn't that at all. The sword of the spirit is makaria. It's a dagger. It's short. It's incisive. It must hit a vulnerable spot or it doesn't do any damage. The sword of the Spirit, then, is not something general, but something specific. Now, notice further. The word here is not the word logos. The normal Greek word logos would be used for a general word. The Bible is the logos. Christ is the logos. A general word is the logos. But when the Bible wants to speak of a specific, it uses the word rhema or rhemata. Now, watch this. The sword of the Spirit is the specific statement of the Word of God that meets the specific point of the temptation. People say, well, I have the sword of the Spirit, I own a Bible. Well, listen, you can own a Bible warehouse and you won't have the sword of the Spirit. Having the sword of the Spirit is not owning a Bible, but knowing the specific principle in the Bible that applies to the specific point of temptation. And the only way you'll know victory in the Christian life is to know the principle of the Word of God, enabling you to make that application to the specific point where Satan attacks, where the flesh attacks, where the world attacks. As you fill yourself up with the Word of God, it becomes the source of victory. Now, you can't even approach the Christian life without Bible study. It's the source of truth, it's the source of joy, it's the source of victory. And let me give you a fourth item that it is. The Word of God is also the source of growth. Everyone wants to grow. It's a very sad thing to see Christians that don't grow. The reason they don't grow is because they don't get into the Word. They may go to church and sit there. They may take a thimble to church to get it filled up. And then when it gets filled up, they spill it on the steps leaving. Nothing ever happens. That's sad. Peter says this. This is a great text. 1 Peter 2, verse 2. As newborn babes desire the pure milk of the Word, that you may grow by it. Well, in other words, the word is the source of growth. Everyone wants to grow. When I was younger, as a Christian, I didn't know much at all. I wasn't discipled into the body of Christ, and so I was left on my own to study, and therefore I didn't. Cutting to the chase, when I went into seminary, I got a taste of the word of God, and I wanted so much of the word that I could hardly stand it. I pigged out on it and still do. I wanted to grow and grow and grow. I had this tremendous desire to grow, and I realized there was only one way that was going to happen. That was by getting into the Word of God and studying it. Now I eat the Word. It's a full meal. I don't care if I ever eat food. I just want the Word of God. Now, during my seminary days, I determined systematically to study the Word of God, and that's when I began to grow. See, my growth is directly proportionate to the amount of time and effort I spend in the study of the Word of God. When I have time, a time span when I may not study the Word of God I just don't study it as ardently as I usually do. I'm busy with other things or whatever. I kind of feel like I've flattened out, crinkled up like a cornflake before milk goes on it. Then when I begin to diligently study the Word of God, I accelerate. Even though I meditate daily on the Word and the growth pattern picks up, it's nothing like when I spend that quiet time with the Lord and His Word. That's when I really see the growth. Now, interestingly enough, verse 1 kind of lays the groundwork. It says, first of all, we have to lay aside all malice. That's the Greek word kakeia, which means general evil. You've got to set aside sin, guile. Guile means deceit. It's a Greek word for fishhook, hypocrisy and envy, and evil speaking. All right. In other words, you set aside all the evil things, repent for your stumbles, and that gets your life straightened out. Then dive into the Word with a tremendous desire and a voracious hunger, and then you'll begin to grow. That's what the Word can and will do in your life. It will make you grow. You know, the more you grow, the more exciting it becomes. The Word is the source of life, You mature, you're enriched, you grow stronger, and as you grow stronger, you're able to overcome what the enemy places in your path to misdirect you. As you grow stronger, you know more about God, His character, and who you are in Christ. You become enriched in every possible way. In John 6, verse 63, Jesus said this, "The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." Jeremiah said, "Thy words were found, and I did eat them." He's speaking about feeding on the word of God. And again, in James chapter 1, in verse 18, it says, "Of his own will, begot he us with the word of truth." Listen, my friends, the word is a life giver. The word is a life sustainer. The word is a life builder. It's a tremendous nourishment. 1 Timothy chapter 4 adds to our understanding of this. In verse 6, he says, "If thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ." Listen to this great line, "nourished up in the words of faith." The word nourishes us. It feeds us. It builds us. It causes us to grow. At the end of 2 Peter, after he's given this tremendous statement about the collapse of the universe, he talks about the elements melting with fervent heat and all those other things and how it's all going to come down in a crash. And then he says, "What should we do? Should we grow in grace and the knowledge of the Lord?" I'm sorry, not should we. It's not a question. What should we do? Then it's we should grow in grace and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. We grow as we feed on the word of God. God wants us mature. He wants us built up. He wants us strong. And if you examine 1 John chapter 2, you'll find the pattern of growth right there. See, one of the most important scriptures in all the Bible is there. Listen to what it says. "I write unto you, fathers, because you have known him." That is, from the beginning. "I write unto you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because you have known the Father." You see, there are three categories here: fathers, young men, and little children. Now, you'll notice there are three differences as well. "I write unto you, little children, because you've known the Father." "I write unto you, young men, because you've overcome the wicked one." "I write unto you, fathers, because you know him who was from the beginning." Now, do you know what those three things are? Those are categories of spiritual growth. Those are not literally little children, young men, and fathers. It wouldn't do any good to write the verse to a little child because they wouldn't read it anyway. And they couldn't read it. It's talking about levels of spiritual growth. Now, we all start out as little children and we know the Father. That's spiritual daddy, right? You don't know much when you're a new Christian, but you know Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. And God is my Father and he's great and so forth. Now, we speak in spiritual goo-goo, but you don't want to stay there. So you go to the second level, young men. What is the characteristic of a young man? He has overcome the wicked one, past tense. Who is the wicked one? Satan. You mean to tell me that I could reach the point in my life where I actually overcome Satan? Absolutely. You mean I can say I have overcome the wicked one? Yes, that's right. How? Verse 14. "I have written unto you, fathers, because you have known it, was from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because you're strong and the word of God abides in you and you've overcome the wicked one." Now, listen to this. To overcome the wicked one, Satan, you'd have to be strong. There's only one way to be strong, and that's to have the word abiding in you. Do you know what spiritual young man is? Do you know what a spiritual is? A spiritual young man is someone who really knows the word. Here's why I say that. Satan, according to 1 Corinthians 11, comes disguised in an angel of light. According to the Bible, Satan spends 99.9% of his time in false religious systems. The bars, prostitution, crime, lust, the world, and materialism, all of that, and the rest of that sinful stuff, is pretty well taken care of by the flesh. Now, you read Galatians chapter 5, the works of the flesh are these, and they list them all. Satan isn't running around poking you in the ribs about some little sin. Satan's developing worldwide systems of evil. Satan's appearing as an angel of light. His ministers are angels of light, and he does his best and most of his works in false religions. Now, a spiritual young man is someone that overcomes Satan in the sense that he knows enough about the word of God that he's not enticed by false religions, but rather he's angered by them. For example, the characteristic of a spiritual child is, according to Ephesians 4:14, he is tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine. Spiritual babies have trouble with false doctrine. Spiritual young men are people who know their Bible. They know their doctrine, so that false doctrine from Satan doesn't appeal to them at all. But there's a third level. He says, I write to you fathers because you've known him who was from the beginning. All right. Now listen to this. Do you know who the father is? That's the person who's gone beyond the page. He doesn't just know doctrine. He knows the God behind the doctrine. Now, in these three steps, you have the process of spiritual growth. And in them, we see the progression of growth. We start out as babies, and as we feed on the word, we become strong. We never overcome the flesh, but we can overcome the world. Make a note of that. Our faith does that. 1 John 5 says, we can overcome Satan's efforts of false religion doctrine. Does it? That's what it does. We can overcome his false religion, and doctrine does that. We never overcome the flesh. That will always be a problem, but we can have the joy of overcoming Satan's false systems of religion. We fight the flesh every day. Now, I can tell you now that every time a man or a woman gets to the place of being a spiritual young man, they invariably get to the place where false religion makes them angry and they want to go out and fight the cult. You know, then, as they mature past that, they're not so concerned with fighting the cults because they begin to get a taste of who God is. They begin to plumb the depths of the mind of the eternal God, and they begin to stretch toward being a spiritual father and walking in the presence of the Holy One. Now, that's where we ought to go in our growth. Are you listening to me? You cheat yourself if you remain a baby. You cheat yourself if you remain a spiritual young man and all you know is doctrine. You've got to get to the place where you walk in the very presence of God Almighty, the God of the universe. It's there that you really begin to touch the person himself. That's the ultimate end of growth. It's limitless. So, when you study the Word, it becomes the source of growth. Like, it's the source of truth, the source of joy, and the source of victory. So let me give you just a couple more. The Word of God is to be studied because it is the source of power. You know, it's the Word of God that infuses us with power, and there's nothing worse than feeling like an impotent Christian. Read Acts 18, no, erase that from your mind. You read Acts 1, verse 8, and you shall receive power, and someone gets your ear and says the word power is dunamis. Okay, you shall be dynamite. You hear them say, you ought to be exploding all over the world. And then you say to yourself, exploding? I don't even fizzle. I think I'm a dud, zero, a goose egg. I don't have any power. And someone says, you ought to get out there and win people to Jesus Christ. And then you say, well, you're kidding. Not me. You know, I'm like Moses. I have a speech impediment. I can't talk. Now, you see, we really get pushed around by our impotence. We don't know what the power is. The Word of God infuses you with power. From my own life, I can tell you the more I know of the Word of God, the less I fear any situation. Why? Because I know what the resource is for the situation. The Word of God becomes the source of power. In fact, it's a source of power from every direction that you look at it from. Okay, so in the book of Hebrews, it says in chapter 4, verse 12, the Word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. This is a powerful book. Let me tell you, you pick this up and you read it, and it will cut you up. It's powerful stuff. It's a powerful, powerful book. Now, the Apostle Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. And you know, you may find that you have an opportunity to open up the gospel with a non-believer, and you can see the power, you can actually see the power of the gospel of God. It just simply crumbles every bit of philosophy that individual who spent 20 years building up has. All right, in Ephesians 4, verse 23, it says, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. In Romans 12, it says, we can be transformed by the renewing of our mind. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, it says, we can literally be transformed by the Holy Spirit into the very glory of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah! Now, as you focus on the Word of God, it generates a power in your life that's undeniable, but mind-boggling. As you meditate on it, It empowers you. It's kind of like the computer, you know, the old computer adage, garbage in, garbage out. Whatever you put into your computer is just what's going to come out, regurgitating in your life. Okay, so as you feed on the Word of God, as you pump in the Word of God, it's going to come out, well, it's going to come right back out when your buttons get pushed. So it's the source of your energy, the source of your power. In fact, in Ephesians 3, the third chapter, it's tremendously rich. In the first three chapters of Ephesians, the Apostle Paul is saying, I want you to learn this, and learn this, and learn this. It's full of nothing but theology, theology, and right through verse 13, more theology, theology, theology. Great truths, indescribable truths. Now, we've been blessed with all spiritual blessings from heavenlies. All right, from the heavenlies. We've been forgiven. We've been redeemed. We've been accepted in the beloved. We have been given wisdom and prudence. We've been given the information of the knowledge of the ages to know the eternal plan of God. We've been granted the Holy Spirit. We've been sealed with the Holy Spirit. We have the guarantee of the Spirit, and all these glorious things are ours. He just keeps going on and on and on. And we've been made a new man. We are the habitation of the Spirit. We are the household of God. We are the family of God. The middle wall has been broken down between Jew and Gentile, and we've come together in one body, the body of Jesus Christ. We have the unsearchable riches of our Christ. That's ours. To us has been dispensed the mysteries of God. Untold riches are ours. And he continues to go on. And he says in chapter 1, I pray, God, that you will understand that the eyes of understanding would be open, that you will understand and comprehend these glorious truths. And after having said that, all of that, if you just get a grip on these truths, if you just learn these truths, he says, this is verse 20 of chapter 3, listen to it. Now to him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all you can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Have you ever thought about the fact that you can do anything and everything you can think? Have you ever thought about the fact that you can do above and beyond anything you can think? Have you ever thought about the fact that you can do exceeding abundantly above all you can ask or think? Listen, my friends, that's a lot of power, isn't it? Leap tall buildings in a single bound? Come on. No sense flopping around on one cylinder. Frankly, those kinds of resources, as you feed on the Word of God, it has an extremely powerful effect. It actually makes your life an energy source, especially when you're in confrontation with anyone or actually at any time. So, we're to study the Word of God because it's the source of truth, the source of happiness, the source of victory, the source of growth, the source of power, and one more. We're to study the Bible because it's the source of guidance. Now, you know, whenever I want to know what God wants me to do, I go to the Word. People say, oh, I'm searching for the will of God. I actually hear them say that a lot all the time. Well, where is God's will? Most treat God like he's the universal Easter bunny who stashes the loot, his will, in the bushes and then sits in heaven. And while you search for it, he says, you're getting warmer. No, no, no. You're getting colder. That's better now. Now you're getting hot. But that's not true. God's will is easy to find. It's right in his book. If you study the Bible, you'll find over and over and over again the phrase, this is the will of God, or this is God's will. You can know the will of God by studying the Word of God. What does Psalm 119:105 say? It says simply, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Pretty simple. The word is a guide. As I open the Word of God, it guides me. It's amazing how God speaks to me through his word. I mean, if I have a decision to make, I find the place he leads me to in the Bible where someone may have grappled with that same situation and made a similar decision. You know, I try to see how God led them to that decision, or I go to the text in the Bible that gives me a direct answer. God guides us from within his book. There is a subjective element to this, too. As a Christian, we have the Holy Spirit. 1 John 2:20 says, the Spirit dwells within us. 1 John 2:27 says, we have an anointing from God. We don't need human wisdom. The Holy Spirit will teach us. Now that happens when you study the Bible. The Holy Spirit in you takes the Word of God and makes a personal application that will give you guidance. You know what? It's marvelous. That's a marvelous combination to have the truth and the resident truth teacher, you know, right residing in you. In combination, they guide the believer. So what have we said then? Great things. The benefits of studying the Bible is the source of truth, happiness, victory, growth, power, and guidance. Now let me say this and I'll close. What should your response be? You should be saying, wow, I ought to act on that. Now, if this is really true, if the Bible's going to do all these things, then what shall I do? Let me just give you some quick ideas. Now watch. Believe it. Believe it, and by that I mean, if the word says it, believe it deep down. Jesus said to Peter one time, will you also go away? And he said, Lord, where am I going to go? You have the words of eternal life. You couldn't get rid of me if you wanted to. I found the source. I'm sticking here. If it's true, then hang in there. Believe it. Number two, honor it. If this is the word of God, then honor it. In Job 23:12, we have that magnificent statement of Job where he says, I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. Listen closely. If this is the word of God, and it will do everything we just said, believe it and honor it. In fact, in Psalm 138, verse 2, it says, God has magnified his word, now get this one, above all his name. Isn't that amazing? God honors the word. In Ephesus, they worship the goddess Diana, or Artemis. Now, we think of goddess Diana as some svelte and beautiful thing, but you know what? The goddess Diana was actually some horrible, ugly black beast that was one of the most gross-looking things you would ever see. But they worshiped that stupid-looking thing constantly. Do you know why? Because there was a superstition that said it fell out of heaven. And if it fell out of heaven, it was worthy of honor. Well, let me tell you something about the Bible. It fell out of heaven. That statue didn't. This book really did. It's worthy of honor, so believe it and honor it. Number three, love it. Now, I would suggest to you love it because if it's true and it's all true, you'd better love it. The psalmist cried out in Psalm 119, oh, how I love thy law. I love the 19th psalm. He said, the law is sweeter to me than honey from the honeycomb and more to be desired than gold. Yea, than much fine gold. One of the most beautiful portions is Psalm 19, chapter 10. I will praise thee with uprightness of heart when I shall have learned thy righteous judgments. I will keep thy statutes. Oh, forsake me not utterly. How shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. With my whole heart have I sought thee. Oh, let me not wander from thy commandments. Now this is what it says. So then believe it and honor it and love it. And let me give to you a fourth thing, just to remind you of what I said earlier. Obey it. If it's really true, obey it. Respond to it. Say yes to it when it speaks. Continue in it. Follow the admonition of the 1 John chapter 2, verse 5 thing. Whosoever keepeth his word in him, verily is the love of God perfected. It's really what it claims to be, and believe it and honor it and love it and obey it at any price. In fact, in Romans 6:16, it says, to whom you yield yourselves as servants, you obey. If you yield yourselves as servants to God, you obey God. This is part of the bargain. Obey it. Five, fight for it. If it's really true, fight for it. In fact, in Jude 3, it says, earnestly contend for the faith. And the faith there means the body of the revealed truth. Agonize for it. Engage yourself in battle to defend the word of God. If it's really true, it can do the things I've said. Believe it, honor it, love it, obey it, and fight for it. Let me give you one more. Preach it. In 2 Timothy 4, verse 2, Paul simply said this, Timothy, preach the word. If it's really true, then preach it. Believe it, honor it, love it, obey it, fight for it, and preach it. Now, are you ready for this last one? You're not ready, but I'm going to give it to you anyway. Study it. In fact, to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:15, it says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman who needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And the expression rightly dividing means cutting it straight. Cut it straight. Study it so that you can straight out interpret it properly. All right? Cut it straight. And Paul was using the language of a tent maker here. And a tent maker made a tent out of a lot of different animal skins. And he took every one of those animal skins and he cut each piece properly so he could put the whole thing together. If you don't cut every piece right, the whole thing doesn't fit together rightly. So what he's saying is you can't have theology without exegesis. You can't have a total theology of Christianity unless you have the verses rightly interpreted. Okay, so to cut it straight, take study. Charles Spurgeon said, every Christian should study the Bible till his blood is Bibeline. You know what Apollos said about it? I mean, what they said about Apollos. I'm sorry. They commended Apollos in the New Testament and said he was mighty in the Scriptures. So my prayer for you to start with then is that you study the Word of God, that you proclaim it, that you fight for it, that you obey it, that you love it, that you honor it, that you believe it. Now, as we go forward, it's been shown to me by our Lord that his people don't know how to study the Bible. So, since this is the final day of our e-crusade, I'll be happy to send you the How to Study the Bible via email so that you'll have a much easier time in your study of the Word of God. Just email me, masterstouchhs@gmail.com. That's masterstouchhs@gmail.com. Now, let's share in the word of prayer. Father, as we bask in your precious presence, we thank you that we can approach your holy word with great anticipation, knowing what it will do in our lives and through them. We will glorify you, Father, through our lives. In the name of the I Am, the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. God bless you all. See you.